J. Puthucheary's writings, No Cowardly Past, invites us to think and speak about our country with intellectual honesty and courage. Let me put down some propositions as plainly as I can about where I think we stand. One, our political system has broken down in a way that cannot be salvaged by piecemeal reform. Two, our public institutions are compromised by politics, most disturbingly by racial politics and by money. This is to say they have become biased, inefficient and corrupt. Three, our economy has stagnated. Our growth is based on the export of natural resources. Productivity remains low. We now lag regional competitors in the quality of our people when we were once leaders in the developing world. Four, points 1 to 3 that I've just mentioned, regardless of official denials and mainstream media spin, is common knowledge. As a result, confidence is at an all-time low. We are suffering debilitating levels of brain and capital drain. Today, I wanted to share some suggestions on how we might move the economy forward. But our economic stagnation is clearly not something we can tackle or even discuss in isolation from the problem of a broken political system and a compromised set of public institutions. This country is enormously blessed with talent and natural resources. We are shielded from natural calamities and enjoy warm weather all year round. We are blessed to be located at the crossroads of India and China and the Indonesian archipelago. We are blessed to have cultural kinship with China, India, the Middle East, and Indonesia. We attained independence with an enviable institutional framework. We were a federation with a constitution which is the supreme law of the land, a parliamentary democracy, and an independent judiciary, a common law system, and an independent neutral civil service. We had political parties with a strong base of support that produced talented political leadership. We have no excuse for our present state of economic and social stagnation. It is because we have allowed the last set of features, our institutional and political framework, to be eroded that all our advantages are not better realized. So it makes little sense to talk glibly about selecting growth drivers, fine-tuning our industrial or trade policy, and so on, without acknowledging that our economy is in bad shape because our political system is in a bad shape. A case in point is the so-called new economic model. The government promised the world it would be announced by the end of last year. It was put off to the end of this month. Now we are told we'll be getting just the first part of it. And that we'll be getting merely a proposal for the new economic model from the National Economic Advisory Council. Clearly, politics has intruded. The new economic model has been opposed by groups that are concerned that the new economic model might replace the new economic policy. The new economic model might not turn out to be so new after all. The irony in all this is that there is nothing to replace. The new economic policy is the opposite of new. It is defunct and is no longer an official government policy because it was replaced by the new development policy, another old new policy. in 1991. The new economic policy was brought back in its afterlife as a slogan by the leadership of AMNO Youth in 2004. It was and remains the most low-cost way to portray oneself as a Malay champion. Thus, at a time when we are genuinely in need of bold new economic measures, we are hamstrung by the ghost of dead policies with the word new in them. What happens when good policy outlives its time and survives as a slogan? The new economic policy was a 20-year program. It has become, in the imaginations of some, the center of a permanently racialized socio-economic framework. Tun Razak and Tun Dr. Ismail, in the age of the fixed telephone, you even needed to go through an operator, thought 20 years would be enough. Its champions in the age of instant messaging talk about 100 or 450 years of Malay dependency. It had a national agenda to eradicate poverty and address structural inequalities between the races for the sake of equity and unity. The Malays were unfairly concentrated in low-income sectors such as agriculture. The aim was to remove colonial era silos of economic roles in our economy. It has been trivialized into a concern with obtaining equity and contracts by racial quotas. The new economic policy was to diversify the Malay economy beyond certain stereotype occupations. It is now about feeding a class of party-linked people whose main economic function is to obtain and resell government contracts and concessions. The new economic policy saw poverty as a national Malaysian problem that engaged the interest and idealism of all Malaysians. People like James Puthucheary were at the forefront of articulating this concern. Its present-day proponents portray poverty as a communal problem. The new economic policy was a unity policy. Nowhere in its terms was any race specified. It has been reinvented as an inalienable platform of a Malay agenda that at one and the same time asserts Malay supremacy and perpetuates the myth of Malay dependency. It was meant to unite our citizens by making economic arrangements fairer and de-racializing our economy. In its implementation, it became a project to enrich a selection of Malay capitalists. James Puthucheary had warned back in 1959 that this was bound to fail. And I quote, "The presence of Chinese capitalists has not noticeably helped solve the poverty of Chinese households. Those who think that the economic position of the Malays can be improved by creating a few Malay capitalists, thus making a few Malays well-to-do, will have to think again." Close quote by James Puthucheary.